this tune by Herbie Hancock. This was on Herbie Hancock's Blue Note. This was his Blue Note debut album. It's called Taken Off. Let's listen to Drifting.
Yeah, man. Cool. Wow, that's great.
Yes, the Herbie Hancock Institute.
Yeah. Okay. I am really happy to invite for conversation JB Dyas, who, I'll get into that, but thanks for being here.
I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, man, to be involved with this kind of an experience, you know, is huge. And I'm sure by the end, I'll probably be in tears somewhere because it's just such a great thing on so many different levels. So.
Well, the cool thing is that what everybody just heard, these are all high school kids.
Yeah.
All high school kids. And that was last school years, if we could call it a school year, because it was all virtual. But it's part of the Herbie Hancock Institute's national peer-to-peer education program. And what we do is we put together these combos comprising these very talented high school kids, and we take them on tour around the country with major artists, and they go into schools. They go into high schools to teach their brethren, kids their same age, that there's more to music than just rock and roll and hip hop. And if I go in and tell them that, they don't hear me. But when they hear this like ethnically diverse group of kids who are all just getting along and playing great, and they say, check out jazz, they hear that. Also, they get the other message that these kids are getting across to the kids their same age across the country is, do something with your lives. We're doing something with ours. Do something with yours. It doesn't have to be music like it is for us. But, you know, put down the video game, find a passion for something, believe in yourself, and go for it. And when those kids hear that message from kids their same age, they listen.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I want to just first define your job, because wasn't sure, are you the vice president of the Institute, or are you the vice president of education and curriculum development?
Yes, that's my title. I'm Vice President for Education and Curriculum Development for the Herbie Hancock Institute of Jazz, which is a international jazz education and outreach organization. And our main offices are in Washington, D.C., but we have a satellite office here at UCLA. That's where I'm streaming from today, at UCLA. And here we have our college program, the Herbie Hancock Institute of Jazz Performance. And what's very cool about this program is that every student who gets in, first of all, you can't pay to get in. You have to audition to get in. And if you get in, all your tuition at UCLA is covered, your private lessons, your room and board, plus everyone gets a $1,000 per month stipend.
Wow.
So it's the best jazz scholarship in the world.
Oh my God. I did not know that. This is really wild.
And they study with a different teacher every week. Herbie Hancock for a week. Billy Childs was with us. Jerry Braganzi, John Patitucci, Chris Potter, Jeff Keyser.
Every week. Yeah.
Every week or every other week, there's a guest artist.
And so they're giving class on whatever, general theory or whatever.
You know, it's interesting because it's a graduate program. They all have a bachelor's degree already, so they get a master's degree conferred by UCLA. But they only take three bona fide UCLA courses. The rest of everything they do, they form a group. This year it's an octet. It can be anywhere between a quintet and an octet. It's formed every 2 years. And they don't take a jazz history course per se, but they hang out with Herbie Hancock for a week. Or they hang out, the great Jimmy Heath was here all the time before he passed a couple of years ago. They would hang out with Jimmy Heath. They hang out with Wayne Shorter. And by the end of the 2 years, they have a good handle on jazz history. And they play together as a group. So they take all their classes as a group. So whether it's improvisation or composition or just combo rehearsal techniques, whatever, they do that as a group. You know, what's interesting, Cathy, that there was an article in one of the magazines about 5 years ago about how the Herbie Hancock Institute was such an innovative jazz program. But it's really the most traditional jazz program. Because what we do is we get these students together who can all play very well, and we put jazz masters with them, but they play together. It's kind of like how all those that played with Art Blakey learned how to play.
Right.
It's the traditional way. You play with, Thelonious Monk said, you learn how to play jazz two ways. You play with, you study with a jazz master, and you play with your peers.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but of course the difference is that now it's in, it's actually in a form, a school that you actually go to, and it's planned out for you. It's pretty amazing. So was it Herbie's brainchild?
No, it started off as the Thelonious Monk Institute of Jazz.
Oh, okay, right.
About 30 years ago, and then they changed the name about 2 or 3 years ago. Herbie's been the chairman for the last 20 years. And with his contribution to not only music, but to humanity, you know, he's the goodwill ambassador for UNESCO, which is the arm of the United Nations. Mm-hmm. And it was named in his honor about 3 years ago. And it's the Herbie Hancock Institute of Jazz now.
So whose original brainchild was it?
Well, it was a group of people. An opera singer, Miss Fisher, was one of the, you know, what happened was they wanted to honor Thelonious Monk years ago. And they were thinking, what should we do? What should we do? Well, maybe we'll put on a concert, or maybe we'll do something like this. So these people came together, and Tom Carter, who was the Institute president, was involved in this. They said, why don't we have a competition? A Thelonious Monk piano competition. And the students have to, you know, these great players will come in, we'll get these real famous judges like Herbie Hancock and Kenny Barron and people like that to judge them. And we'll give them like $10,000 if they win. It's now $25,000, by the way, but at the time. Yeah. And they play three tunes. One of them has to be a Thelonious Monk tune. So it started off like that. And then they did the piano competition the next year, and they saw that most all the same people who had tried the year before were auditioning again. So then they said, we'll do a different instrument every year. And that competition is still going strong, where it's saxophone 1 year, trumpet 1 year, drums 1 year, guitar 1 year.
Yeah.
And so they said, well, we have this competition. Why don't we start doing some jazz outreach in the schools? So they started doing that. And why don't we start a college program? And that actually started at New England Conservatory. Oh. Well, why don't we do this National Performing Arts High School program? And how about a bebop to hip hop program? So all these things, and this national peer-to-peer program, which is a National Performing Arts High School program, which I oversee. So now the Institute is got all these different components. You can check it out, just hancockinstitute.org. You can see all the different things we do all over the world. And now we do International Jazz Day. International Jazz Day, we produce that, the All-Star Global Concert every year in conjunction with UNESCO from the United Nations. And last year, there were over a billion participants with a B, a billion.
Now, when you say participants, audience or?
Involved in some way or another, either watching, presenting jazz clinics, doing listening seminars, having a jazz reading. There's you just go to jazzday.com and there's all different ways you can get involved with presenting or attending. And we do it in a different city. Now, this last year, of course, it was virtual.
Yeah.
But we've done it in a different country every year,
right.
Australia, Cuba, Russia. When we did it in the United States last time, we did it at the White House, and President and Mrs. Obama hosted.
And didn't you say that you and I were in the Japan one, the first one, right?
It wasn't the first one, but it's still one of my favorite ones,
yeah.
Osaka.
Yeah, we were
Osaka,
both
Osaka, Japan.
There.
Yes, yeah. That's right. It was the second or third one, I think.
That was an amazing one. I still actually have vivid memories of it. There were people that I had never heard of. There was, you know, some of my favorite, like John Scofield sat in with almost everybody. And the drummers and the African, there was some African singer that was absolutely fantastic. Sheila E. and her father. And that was just, and John Beasley, of course. And yeah, that was, it was such a great concert. Really wonderful, wonderful.
You know, they're all star-studded. They're all star-studded. When we did the one at the White House, we also had some crossover artists like Aretha Franklin and Sting and little Joey Alexander played and floored everybody. Now he's not so little anymore, but at that time he was just, you know, it was one of the most beautiful, because they put together, you know, Beasley, John Beasley, besides being a phenomenal jazz pianist, he's just an incredible musical director.
Yeah.
So he puts together, you know, the mix and match with all these great players.
Yeah.
And one of the presentations was Wayne Shorter on saxophone, just a trio, Wayne Shorter, Esperanza Spalding, and Joey Alexander. So we had this huge generation gap.
Yeah.
Different ethnicities, different backgrounds,
yeah,
different ages galore.
Yeah.
And what was the great equalizer? Jazz.
Yeah. Okay, this is where the story kind of goes. For me, it gets me really excited and turned on because it goes into an area, and I think you said, I'm looking forward to hearing Herbie speak with the ambassador
the conversation that you're going to play. In fact, what these kids, what you just heard, the kids, we call them the National Peer-to-Peer Jazz Septet.
Oh, and by the way, let's talk about those kids, because, you know, let's just not move on too quick, because I listened to one and I thought, wow, great. And then the next one was like, wow, great. And the next one was, wow. So they seem like they have their voice, you know, really quite strong and present. And I guess it's because of what you're saying, especially the peer-to-peer program, but also hanging out with Herbie Hancock for a week, then hanging out with Wayne Shorter for a week, then hanging and getting all that information, being able to play with each other and getting direction. I mean, wow, they're really, all of them just were stellar.
Now, those kids you heard were not the college program. They're not the ones that are hanging out with Herbie and Wayne. That's our National Performing Arts High School program. We're involved with 12 performing arts high schools around the country. So these are kids who are really into it. The one here in Los Angeles, wow, is the Los Angeles County High School for the Arts. And two of the students that you heard were...
Sorry.
No problem.
I'm such a loud sneezer, sorry.
That's okay. But two of those students are from Los Angeles, and we had a couple from Baltimore, one from Houston, one from Miami, and one from New Orleans. So what we do when pre-COVID and again this year is that I visit all these schools and I work with these kids for 3 days at each of these schools all over the country. And then I am covertly auditioning them for the two all-star group, quote-unquote all-star groups that we put together and that we tour with a major artist. And we've toured with Antonio Hart and Ingrid Jensen and Bobby Watson and Delfeayo Marsalis and Steve Wilson. I mean, it's always great, not only great, Christian McBride, not only great players, but great educators. So this year we did it virtual, And that was a webinar that we did with Herbie and with U.S. Secretary of Education Miguel Cardona, who's in the cabinet in D.C. He's the U.S. Secretary of Education. So we kind of, they played what you just heard them play. Then we do a little explanation on what jazz is, how it works. And then you're going to hear Herbie and U.S. Secretary of Education Miguel Cardona talk about the importance of jazz in our public schools.
Right. Okay. This is exciting. Okay. Let me find myself. Here we go. And the number, I believe I have.
You could pick it up right where you left off.
Well, actually, that is not the discussion. The discussion is much little later. I have.
Oh, is that okay? Right before the discussion, what happens, Kathy? And you might want to play this later, or just let people know they can find it on YouTube.
Yeah.
But the kids, we explain how jazz works, and then we go right into the conversation with Herbie and Miguel Cardona after that.
Right. Okay. All righty.
We could get a discussion between Secretary Cardona.
Who is speaking right now?
This is the number one counsel for the U.S. Department of Education. The top lawyer there, big jazz fan. Oh. And big jazz aficionado. So he introduces Herbie and Miguel Cardona right here.
Oh, okay.
Cardona and Herbie Hancock. Maureen Dowling and I talked about it. We wished for it and we suggested it with JB and it came true. And so now it is indeed a great honor and a special privilege to turn the program over to Secretary Cardona, who will introduce a discussion with Herbie Hancock to discuss jazz, education, the arts, and anything else that comes to their mind. After all, that is the magic of jazz. I now welcome Secretary Cardona.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you. I'm so excited about the conversation. I'm excited about what I've seen so far. Phil and Maureen, thank you for your work preparing this and all the great work you're doing behind the scenes to make this possible. And I love reading the messages in the Q&A. You know, I agree that peer-to-peer all-star jazz septet was amazing. So if you haven't yet, just make sure you let them know how much love you have for them and how awesome they were by writing a message in the comments so that they can see it as well. We got messages from Indonesia. I love it. I love it. What an honor for me to be here. I want to welcome everyone, students, parents, musicians. You know, you're such an important part of what we do at the Department of Education. And to have this opportunity, to have this conversation with the giant, Herbie Hancock is one of the true honors of this job for me. So, you know, we're going to get into the conversation very quickly. I just want to acknowledge, you know, everybody knows Herbie Hancock for his amazing music and he's on that Mount Rushmore musicians. But equally as important is something that I know he does with his heart. He has such a generous philanthropic spirit. He was given a gift and he uses that gift to provide for others. So Herbie, not only are you an amazing musician, but you're an amazing person. And I'm honored, man. I'm honored. So I look forward to the conversation. And before we get into it, you know, I'm a father before Secretary of Education. I'm a father and I have two children, a 14-year-old, 16-year-old, as Phil mentioned, and they love music. They play, they sing, thanks to their amazing music teacher, Brian Sear and Dave Pelletier and Sierra Cohen, for inspiring them to use music as an art form to communicate. And I know the impact that it had during the pandemic when they weren't around the other musicians or the other theater students, just that sense of community that music provides, that sense of healing that music provides. And I know especially after hearing those amazing students perform, that music will help us heal out of this pandemic and get back to our schools in a place that's better than ever before. Music is healing. And jazz, I mean, we can learn from jazz, Herbie, right? We know that in the pandemic, we've had to improvise, right? And what better form to improvise than jazz? Talk to me about that, Herbie.
Jazz is an amazing art form. It gives you the opportunity to express yourself in an infinite number of creative ways, because it's not stuck in just one moment. It allows you to continue to build and to grow and to improvise. That's what improvisation really is about, expressing yourself with your own words, not just the words that another composer wrote. You might use a format that another composer wrote, but using your own words, your own use of the language, you know, so it's the development of not only the things that you've learned from others, but things that you've learned along the way by improvising in jazz and being able to express in your own way, not just the notes that your teacher taught you,
right,
but the notes that if you've gone on beyond that to find new ways to express yourself that perhaps the teacher was not able to tell you about, because these are the individual ways that a human being is able to bring himself, you know, his own spirit to the music.
It's and so that's affirming.
Uplifting. It's uplifting of the spirit to it.
Definitely. It's self-affirming. It's almost as individual as you were mentioning. It's as individual as a fingerprint, right? Yes, you have notes, but as you said, you're using your experience and how you interpret things to make it your own. And that's the beauty of what I saw a little while ago. And that's the beauty of jazz. It's your own. It's your own fingerprint on something.
Yeah. You know what else I love about it is that it takes a lot of courage to play jazz because you're up there when it's time for you to improvise. Mm-hmm. Actually, improvisation is almost in every moment, particularly with the pianist. Because he may be accompanying another soloist besides accompanying himself when he's playing his own solo. But the courage to not know exactly where you're going to go, and then when that moment comes, to kind of jump off that cliff. and that takes courage to do that. After a while, you get used to that fear is that feeling of it's gonna be okay. So it develops this spirit of being fearless.
Yeah,
everybody needs that.
You know, it's true. Like, so I look at it, I'm trying to compare it to how we've in education, we're talking about reopening schools, we're talking about being innovative, thinking outside of the box. You know, jazz teaches that. And you talked about having that confidence and that almost that self-affirmation that I'm going to take that leap. And it teaches leadership. It teaches, like, I got this. I can do this.
Oh, absolutely. It's very, like, life-affirming.
Right.
At the same time, because you're working with other musicians and you're listening to them and you're being fed new material by the other musicians. And you don't know what they're gonna feed you next in the next moment. But as you hear that, you're kind of adding that to this soup that you're making or this salad that you're making. And the one of the main important things is that you're not being judgmental about it.
Right.
This is what Miles showed in that example that Phil mentioned. When I played, I really did play a really wrong chord. And I heard it. It took me years to figure out how did Miles turn this disaster into like an elevated bridge. I had no idea. I thought it was alchemy or something.
That's amazing, though. You know, you bring up, yes, it builds that self-affirmation, but there's a level of listening and interdependence and collaboration that goes on in jazz that's pretty unique. It really lifts it, where you're feeding off someone else, and as you describe, you take it to another level.
Right, and it's immediate. Yeah. You don't have time to think about it. And actually, through doing it over and over again with many people, you know, trying different things and little by little growing, you get to the point where the brain gets in the way. And something else inside takes over. It allows you to develop the ability to bypass the brain, go right from the heart.
That's amazing.
And have that motivate you. How you feel, that's part of being, part of living. And it's so liberating. And we know that from our own experiences with our students, how they have exhibited change in the way that they see themselves. They may not be as aware of it as we, the educators, are, but what's happening is that they are learning to find that they are more than what they thought they were.
Right. Now, I'm gonna stop this for a second. I mean, we could, and I'll be happy to play it more too. I just wanted to chat for a minute about all this, you know?
Sure.
I mean, you and I don't know each other that well, but I am so on this line of thinking. As a matter of fact, I wrote a book that I'm kind of getting together for self-publishing right now on how a life lesson is the same as a lesson in voice technique and the same as a lesson in singing jazz. It's the same exact lesson. And that's only just what I know well, you know. I mean, it's the same in driving a truck or planting trees or, you know. But the thing is, the lessons are so similar. For instance, and he already touched upon this, but for instance, communication, just the concept of communicating, right? In life, of course, when you, especially in a problem, right, you have to communicate, and that's what solves things and helps you go on. Voice technique, actually, when you focus on communicating, technique actually aligns. And of course, in jazz, right, what he was just speaking about, you stop thinking, you're communicating, and that actually makes the jazz come through. So it's, I mean, that's why I get so excited about all this stuff, because it's not, you know, it's kind of not the material universe so much. I mean, we're using the material universe, but really it's consciousness and spiritualness, and that's really the answer to everything. And of course, as you and I know, and a lot of other people know, it's really what human beings are supposed to, the pieces that make all this up is what human beings would benefit from focusing on and using, which is why the arts are so crucially important to support, right?
Well, exactly right. I mean, we go around to all these schools all over the country and teach kids about jazz, but more importantly, far more importantly, we teach them about the values that jazz represents, like teamwork,
yeah,
and unity with ethnic diversity, and the correlation of hard work and goal accomplishment. You know, in jazz, it's a one-to-one correlation. You know, the more you practice, the better you get.
Yeah.
It also teaches us about democracy. There's no better example of democracy than a jazz ensemble, because what's the definition of democracy? It's individual freedom, but with responsibility to the group.
Yep.
That's what jazz is, individual freedom, but with responsibility to the group. Also, jazz teaches us the vital importance of really listening to one another. You know, in jazz, you can't function unless you're intensely listening to one another. I mean, the bass player doesn't know what to play unless he or she's listening to the drummer, and the drummer doesn't know what he or she is going to play unless he or she's listening to the bassist. And they both have to listen to the pianist and the whole rhythm section, piano, bass, and drums. They have to listen to the horn players and the vocalist, and the vocalist has to listen to them. So everybody's intensely listening to one another. You know, it teaches, jazz teaches us that vital importance of really listening to one another. I always thought, wouldn't it be great if all our world leaders were jazz musicians? Listening to one another, supporting one another,
yeah,
tolerating one another. You know, it's interesting, Cathy, that during the pandemic, where so many students didn't do well across the country, I mean, yeah, all the studies are showing that, I mean, some people say it's even a completely lost year. But I found that the jazz kids at all these performing arts high schools that I was Zooming at, not only did okay, but many of them strived. Many of them thrived while they were striving, and thriving. Mm. And, you know, I talked to the directors of jazz studies at these schools, and I said, you know, it seems to me these jazz students are doing better than some of the other students. Is that true? Like better than the dance students or the drama students or the visual arts students or just the regular academic students? And they said, without a doubt, without a doubt. I talked to this one performing arts school's student, one of these kids on the video, and said, you know, this has been a blessing because I get all my schoolwork done in 3 hours on Zoom. So I don't have to go to school for 8 hours where a lot of my time is wasted. And so I don't have my 45 minute each way commute time to school. So I'm practicing then and I'm listening. And I'm practicing with the Jamie Abersold play along records that have people like bass players like Christian McBride and Ron Carter and Rufus Reed on them, and drummers like Ben Riley and pianists like Kenny Barron. I mean, incredible rhythm sections to play with rather than their school rhythm section where the bass player is always getting lost and, you know, the drummer's turning the beat around. So they memorize a lot of tunes. So I was wondering why these jazz musicians were doing better than the other kids. And again, this is just anecdotal evidence, but boy, does it seem to be true.
Yeah.
And I've come up with a theory. And my theory is this, that jazz musicians in our DNA, we are used to overcoming problematic working conditions. I mean, if we go to the gig and the piano's out of tune and the acoustics are bad and the stage is too small and the bread is way light and the drummer's hi-hat clutch doesn't work, we still have a great set. It never occurs to us not to still have a great set. Even if the drummer doesn't show up, we still have a great set. And that's in our DNA. We see chord changes. We negotiate chord changes. We have to come up with something that's better than what's there already. And I think that DNA helped us through the pandemic.
Yeah. Also, I think just the nature that we're improvising all the time.
Yeah.
And even though all people improvise all the time, you know, you wake up, it's raining and you thought you were going to go for a picnic, you know, I mean, just, or you get out, you know, you hurt your foot, or, you know, everything is improvisation. But of course, we as jazz people are supposed to be improvising. So we're focused on it. We're doing it all the time. And I think that has a lot to do with what you're talking about, a lot to do with people doing better, because they're actually, as you said before, you know, the pieces of jazz actually teach people life lessons, you know. So improvisation, I'm always talking about that. It's funny, my husband is not a jazz person. He's rock and roll and blues mostly. And So of course, we've been together 20 years and I've of course introduced various things that I thought would appeal to him, right? And the idea of improvisation, I mean, for years he was actually the lighting board operator on The Tonight Show. Hmm. Talk about improvisation. You know, every day you're faced with a new group to light and then stuff happens, you know? So he was always creating in an artistic way and improvising, but he didn't think of those terms. You know, so it's really, it's quite interesting, you know, to help him kind of integrate those ideas and terms and just actually accept that he's already doing it. He already knows, but it's actually something and he can work on it as much as he wants to and focus on it and get a quality, a higher quality of awareness because of it, you know.
Well, I agree, and I tell this to students all the time when I go into these schools that, Cathy, what you and I are doing right now is improvising.
Yeah.
And we've decided what language we're going to use. We're using English, and we both know the language. We've both studied it. First of all, we started learning it right when we were born. You know, you start listening to people, and you start trying to imitate it, and then you go to grammar school. To learn how to speak better, and you learn about how words and sentences go together, subjects and predicates and nouns and verbs and adverbs and dangling participles. So now that we also know the subject matter that we're talking about.
Yeah.
Well, jazz musicians learn how to play, I tell these students, the exact same way we've learned how to speak. They listen to a lot of people play. They try it, even if they don't know what's going on. Then they study music theory. They listen a lot, they emulate,
yep.
And they study instrumental technique. It's kind of like studying pronunciation when yep. you're speaking. And study music theory, it's kind of like studying grammar, how rather than how words and sentences go together, how chords and scales go together. So, and then they get together and they improvise, but they're having a conversation, but rather than using English, they're using music.
Mm-hmm.
And they're using this dialect of jazz to say what they're thinking and feeling, because all a language can do is communicate thoughts and feelings. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
So that's what jazz does, communicates thoughts and feelings. Now, where English has an advantage over jazz
uh-huh.
is that in English, I could say, Cathy, would you be willing to go down to the 7-Eleven and get me a loaf of bread? I can't say that in jazz. I can't go, you say, sure, JB, white or weak. But jazz can communicate far deeper emotions
yeah.
than words can. So, you know, I give this exercise to the students. I say, I want you to write down all the words that you know that describe emotions. Love, hate, melancholy, sadness, upset. They write down about 30 or 40 words, and maybe some of them will get a thesaurus and write down another.
Yeah.
But in jazz, it's infinite.
Yes. Now, I would like to veer off of this path for a minute because I want to find out. I was thinking about this before we talked. I was thinking, now, how the heck does one get into the position of Vice President of Education and Curriculum Development at the Herbie Hancock Institute? I know you're a bass player. And let's come up a little bit of your background, okay, and where you came from. And you wanted to be a bass player. Did you love jazz?
It's a very serendipitous route how I got here. I grew up in New York.
Uh-huh.
My mom and dad were both in the theater. My dad was a director, producer. So I came from an artistic family. My mother was an actress and a drama teacher. And, you know, my dad would, since I can remember, since I was 4, 5, 6 years old, he'd say, Jim Billy, stay out of the theater. You don't need this. And my dad was mildly successful. You know, he had one Broadway hit. He directed Send Me No Flowers on Broadway in the 60s.
Oh, cool.
But mostly it was summer stock and winter stock and industrial shows and, you know, piecing together a living. So he had a medium career, but it was always a struggle. You know, it's always a struggle. He says, you know, you're a smart kid. You don't need this. I will pay for your college. I'll send you to college, but not if you're going to be a drama major. You can be anything. So I remember when I was 12 or 13, I came to him and I said, I've decided what I'm going to do, Dad. And he said, you're not going into the theater, are you? And I said, no, something far more stable.
Oh,
jazz musician. So what actually happened with me is that I was actually a rock and roll, before I was a bassist, I was a rock and roll guitarist.
Oh.
And I was, you know, I was like the garage band kid. I had the, you know, the rock band in high school, and I was like the best high school, I was the best, you know, guitar player in my high school. And
uh-huh.
These were the kind of things where, you know, you'd practice for weeks and weeks and weeks, and all the kids would hang out while you're playing your rock and roll, you know, for a 1 hour sock hop gig, you know. So right after high school, you know, I barely got myself through high school, which is, you know, which shocked my parents and a lot of people now that I have a PhD, that I, you know, I was like the D-minus kid. And it wasn't because I wasn't smart. It was because I was playing in this rock band all the time. And I was in love with the keyboard player. She and I were an item. And that took all my time rather than studying. So right after high school, I never wanted to go to college. And I lucked into a gig playing six nights a week on tour with a top 40 rock and roll band. And I traveled the country, and I remember I was making more money than my dad. And I thought, man, I never need to go to college, man. This is great. We're traveling all around. I'm playing six nights a week. This is the day, Cathy, you might be too young to remember this, but this is when every Hilton Hotel, every Sheraton, every Marriott, every Holiday Inn, they had a top 40 band.
I know. I was there, man.
Yep. And so, and there were hundreds of these bands crisscrossing the country, and I was in one of them.
Yeah.
So I'm a rock and roll guitar player, copying the notes from the record exactly.
Yeah. Because
That's what you did. Same solo every night.
Yep.
So the keyboard player and the bass player in the band, we would play 2 weeks in a place, and we had a Sunday off, and they said, we're going to go to this jam session. Come along. So I go to the jam session, and I go up to play, and I'm 18 years old, and we go up to play, and they say, come on up, you can do it. And they call Green Dolphin Street. And I absolutely fell on my face. I fell on my face. And I remember it was such an aha moment for me, because I was so embarrassed, because I'd been carrying myself like I was all that. And I was nowhere. So I really respected the pianist, the keyboard player and the bassist in this rock band I was playing in. They were into jazz. I really respected them because they were older and wiser. One was 19, the other one was 20. So I said, how'd you learn how to do this? How did you? And they said, we went to community college for a semester. Community college? Yeah, they taught us how to like read music and stuff, man, and like how to, what chords are. And I went, wow. So I got to get me into one of these. So I remember the band broke up in Sioux City, Iowa. And I had a friend at Kalamazoo, Michigan, Western. You know how people pick their schools because they want to study with this person? They got this great program.
Yes.
Well, I picked my school because I had a friend who said I could stay at his place till I found a place to live. I could crash at his house, and that's how I picked my school. So I went to Western Michigan University, which by the way now is a great jazz school.
Absolutely.
So I so it took me 7 years to get my bachelor's degree because I was on the road, off the road, on the road, on the. I did two cruise ships during that time, on the road, off a semester at cruise ships.
Yeah.
So I find myself in Miami, Florida, and I'm playing in this great group called the Kids Next Door. And this was my group. And We played the top 40 music of the day, Donna Summer and the Bee Gees and all the disco stuff. But we also sang four-part harmony like the Modern Airs and Manhattan Transfer and Singers Unlimited. That's what we were. So we were huge in the Palm Beaches.
Yeah.
We played in the Palm Beaches. So I'm on this, I'm playing six nights a week. I'm making more money than I ever have. And so I'm living the life, playing with great players, doing this gig. And we play every night, and then I hang out, you know, do the thing. And I found myself getting up at 3 p.m. And the reason why I was getting up at 3 p.m. is because that's when General Hospital came on. And I was hooked. Those were the Luke and Laura days. Man, so I had a revelation. I actually looked in the mirror one day and said, your life's got to be more than playing every night, hanging out and getting up to watch General Hospital. So at Florida Atlantic University in Boca Raton, I had made a friend with the director of jazz studies there named Bill Prince, one of the best musicians, jazz musicians, multi-instrumentalist. He's on three Buddy Rich records. I mean, he had a great career. So I make an appointment to go see him. And I say, you know, I'm playing with this band, you know, all the great players making good money. But man, I'm getting up at 3 p.m. There's got to be something more. He says, why don't you try teaching? I said, no, man, I don't know. I don't know if that's my thing. He says, I think you'd be good at it. He said, for me, it's perfect. You know, I was on the road all these years, and I went back and got my degrees, and I'm here, director of jazz studies at Florida Atlantic University, and I can play just as many dates as I want to play. I don't have to play any date to make the rent. I'm only playing good dates. And why don't you try it? Well, as fate would have it, his phone rang, and it was the chairman of the music department at Broward Community College in Fort Lauderdale. And he calls and he says, Bill, he said, my guitar teacher, adjunct guitar teacher, teaches one day a week, has 7 students, comes in one day a week. He just left. He just went on the road with the Pointer Sisters, which was a big rock group in those days, big pop group. And we need somebody to finish the semester. It was like halfway through the term. You got anybody? And Bill said, well, hold on just a minute. He said, look, you want to do this teaching thing or not? And I was on the spot because he was, you know, I came there and he said, right, he says, look, I got a gig for you right now, teaching one day a week at this school. And so I went, okay. So he put me in touch with the guy, started that very next week, going one day a week, teaching guitar lessons, 7 hours, one right after the other. And I loved it. You know, back in the band, the kids next door, I was talking about my students all the time. And I remember the drummer once said, on behalf of everybody in the band, I would just like to say, could you please shut up about your students? That's all you're talking about all the time. We got a band here to go. And so that's what got me into teaching. Huh. Fast forward, I did a master's degree at the University of Miami in jazz pedagogy, a PhD in music education at Indiana University. And I taught at New World School of the Arts, director of jazz studies, performing arts high school. I was a professor at Miami-Dade College. And I was the executive director of the Brubeck Institute. Mm. And I've been here since 2005 at the Herbie Hancock Institute.
Wow.
Okay. And that's my story.
That's an interesting story. When did you start playing bass instead of guitar? Or was that, I just saw that you were playing bass, so I assumed you were bass.
Yes, when I went down to Florida, and this is how I got down to Florida. My father was directing a play at the Royal Poinciana Playhouse, and I was on the road and with a top 40 band, and we were in Virginia Beach, Virginia, and the band broke up, and my girlfriend and I broke up, and you know, I'm 21 years old, and I did what every red-blooded American boy would do when that happens, is I called my mom. And she said, well, you know, your dad's in Palm Beach directing a show. He's got 3 weeks left on that gig. Why don't you give him a call and maybe you could just, you know, work, stay down there with him and see what you're going to do next. So I went down there and I was starting to, my dad said, you know, rather than just, you know, sitting at the beach crying in your beer, why don't you try to find a gig? And I had an electric bass because every rock and roll guitar player can play electric bass. Just goes with it. So I was looking for any gig that I could. So I said, I play guitar, electric bass. And I got a gig playing at the Holiday Inn as electric bass with this pop singer named Jimmy Rivers. And for 9 weeks, and I've been a bass player ever since. So I did my master's degree on bass, and I did my I did my PhD on bass as well. I've been a bass player ever since. I still play guitar, but I don't gig on it.
Guitar man, yeah. Okay.
Rock and roll. So, and you know, and I remember hearing, you know, walking, and I was telling you about those the 19 and 20 year old, and I walk into their, and they carried a turntable around with them, and they're listening to jazz. And And I walk into their hotel room, and they're playing Chameleon by Herbie Hancock, the Headhunters. And I say, what's that? And they say, that's jazz. And I say, that's jazz? I got to get me into this. So it's interesting that now I work for Herbie Hancock, and it was his record that really turned me around.
That's why
got me into jazz, you know.
Yeah. Okay, now that I know that you were a guitar player too, I think I'm going to have to give you a few CDs because I was like one of the only singers who sang with Ted Green.
Oh.
I actually made a video, a DVD and a CD of our past stuff, and it's really great because you really can see on the DVD, you can really see it. Actually, we did the DVD at Rocco's. Remember Rocco's, what now is Vibrato's? Did you ever go there?
No, I've only been there because since it's been Vibrato.
It was a great small lounge, but open, but small lounge. And that was actually the only place that had more modern jazz, you know, Peter Erskine and people like that. It was before the Blue Whale, and actually Rocco helped June at the Blue Whale kind of developed the, you know, the personnel who would come in there. But anyway, it's great because you really, it's very home, a home style video, but you really see Ted playing, which is just wonderful. He was such a great guy. And I also recorded a record with Joe DiOrio as a duo. And that's really a pretty thing. I'm going to have to share those with you.
I would love to hear them. Two of my favorite, and you're one of my favorite vocalists, so two of my favorite guitarists. Ted Green is like the chord chemistry. I mean, he's the cat that plays all the hippest voicings and so forth. So was it a duo with Ted as well?
Yep.
Yeah, so that I would really like to hear that because that's his thing. I mean, he's a great player all the way around, but doing all these great chord substitutions and inversions and voicings, it's unbelievable what he knows.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, the funny quick little anecdote was when I first came here, I was 21 and I was working as a waitress at Dante's, and Ted came in and he fainted because he was very sensitive at that point to sound. And he fainted because of the volume of the band. And I was like leaning over him. And I had gone to Berkeley right before for flute, actually, because at the time I went, they didn't even have vocals. And there was many guitar players at Berkeley. That was like the probably the most instrument played, you know. And so I heard about Ted Green all the time. So when I met him, it was like, oh yeah, I know your name, and would you like to play a little? And he said, yeah, sure. I didn't realize he wasn't really playing out very much because, believe it or not, he felt like he wasn't as good as people thought he was. So it's over humble, this guy. So we got this act together that was not, so he loved to change keys in the song, right? So these songs I had been singing for years, because I grew up with a musical family, we would change keys halfway through. So the next gig after Ted, I just didn't even, I was clueless for some reason. I don't know why. I had been singing all my life. I didn't realize if I said it was in B flat, it really wasn't in B flat, because halfway through, Ted and I would change to E flat. So that first gig outside of Ted was a real shocker for me. I didn't know what the hell was going on. It took me a minute, but I got it really fast, but it was really shocking and funny. But Ted was, he was just such a special individual and you know, musically a genius, but a real special person too. He would have fit in with the Herbie Hancock Institute. He was extremely gracious. He charged people $12 a lesson, and the greatest guitar players would go over to his house and pick his brain, take lessons from him. So, and then Joe DiOrio is, you know, another absolute genius musician, just gorgeous, gorgeous concepts and ideas, kind of, you know, along the Larry Kuntz idea, right, of thinking.
Yeah, and I love Joe's playing modern,
yeah,
but still with reverence to the tradition.
I agree. Yeah, I love players like that too. Jim Hall, right? Modern, but in the pocket too.
Yeah.
Just really beautiful.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people don't know about Ted Green. I hope all those who are listening and watching today just Google Ted Green. Definitely undernoted, you know, he's underrated. One of these great, great players. And again, as far as being an accompanist, you know, he's a chord meister. I mean, man, just
incredible.
Brilliant.
Yeah, really brilliant. Yeah. It's funny because he was in love with the movie themes, you know, so he would play the most gorgeous arrangements of movie themes. And the other night, I heard Otmara Ruiz playing solo movie themes that he had over the pandemic. Talk about an undersung genius. During the pandemic, he had turned on YouTube, because he's in love with movie themes, and transcribed, and then was playing them solo. And this concert was, it was like a tapestry. It was so gorgeous. It was a really unique listening experience, actually. It was beautiful, just beautiful.
Love hearing that.
Yeah. Yeah,
love hearing that. Yes, some of the movie, I mean, look at all the great standards that have come from Broadway and movies.
Oh, you know? Yeah.
There's a lot of material there.
I remember when we met at Sam First, your lovely wife was with you, who I really got was a strong supporter of you. I really got that. And she was the one who said, "You're coming out with a new record." So I'd like to talk about that too, because, you know, this is about you and not just about the Herbie Hancock Institute of Jazz, but it's, of course, it's fascinating. So what about your new record?
No, it wasn't a new record. It was a new website.
Okay. I'm sorry. I thought it was a record.
Yeah, I have a new website.
I'm going to go to it.
It's just jbdyas.com.
Right.
And what I've done here, Cathy, is I've got all my articles. I've written, you know, 10 or so articles for Downbeat, and I've got all my clinic packets and all my videos, and everything is up here. Everything is free. So, like, if you go up to clinics there.
Yep.
And you can just see those are the, you go ahead and click on jazz clinics. These are all the clinics that I do for, and I do these all over the country for students. And if you go back to clinics, and you can see the jazz pedagogy clinics. These are ones that I do for current and future teachers on how to teach jazz. That's my thing. I'm a jazz pedagogue. I am a bassist. I'm a professional bassist. I still play. I've played, you know, literally thousands of, you know, well over a couple thousand dates in my career.
Yeah.
But I am a jazz pedagogue. That's my thing now. And if you go to the clinic packets, There people can download all these things, how to go, how to get the big scholarship, jazzing up jazz band. You know, I go around the country and I go to these high schools and I hear some of these schools, these high school bands, the jazz bands, and some of them sound pretty slick.
Yeah.
But problem is that they're not playing a lick of jazz.
Yeah.
It's like concert band with a swing beat.
Uh-huh.
Because I'll go up to the second alto player and I'll say, what's the form of this tune?
Yeah.
They won't know. I go up to the second trumpet player. What's the chord progression? What's the definitive recording? Who's on the definitive recording? They don't know. And I believe that one of the most fundamental aspects of being a jazz musician is being hip. And I talk about this all the time. Jazz musicians are amongst the hippest people I know. And what's the definition of hip? It means being in the know. Being up to date, knowing what's up, knowing the latest, knowing what's real. Jazz musicians, they need to know what's up. So if you don't know the definitive recording, you don't know the chord progression, you don't know the form of the tune, it's concert, you're playing the second alto part. That's not jazz, that's concert band with a swing beat.
Mm-hmm.
So jazzing up jazz band, we teach everybody. Everybody in that band learns everything about the tune they're playing. So one of the things that I do is I co-direct the Los Angeles All-City jazz band, which is made up of the best high school jazz musicians in Los Angeles.
Uh-huh.
I co-direct it with my good friend and colleague, Tony White. And every kid that's in that band can play for whatever tune we're playing in the big band, they can play the head and they can play the changes. They know they can solo on it. They can all solo on, they can all play F and B flat blues and rhythm changes as opposed to just the second alto part. And that's the jazz way. And all that's explained in this jazzing up jazz band.
Each of these is
you click on each of them and they're each a packet.
This is quite a huge gift. There's your bio, there's testimonials about you, articles that you've written.
Yeah, right? You can click on that. There's some of the articles from Downbeat and Jazz Ed and
great.
And there's how to get it, living the dream, how to get a job in jazz education. So these jazz musicians that can play very well and they say, well, you know, I want to get a job. I want to teach at a university or high school or do clinics. Yeah. Step by step, how to get the big scholarship. Any student can go to school for free. Mm-hmm. It's not only about playing well, but it's playing right. You got to audition in a certain way. And I talk about what they want to hear.
Fantastic.
The audition panel.
Wow. And then videos of you teaching.
Yes. Right? Videos of me teaching. There's the one you were just playing with Herbie and Secretary Cardona.
Uh-huh.
And then this is What is Jazz? That's an introduction I did for International Jazz Day last year. It's a 1-hour video. It's perfect for a 1-hour What is Jazz class, like for a music appreciation class or a music history class where you just want to give the basics on what jazz is.
Yeah.
And then this is how jazz works. It's like a 10-minute video on how a jazz tune is put together. And I do that one with the peer-to-peer septet.
Uh-huh.
And that's another interview similar to this one that I did a while ago. And then this one, How to Teach Jazz Fundamentals, the one at the bottom, that's a seminar I did in New Orleans. And that's about an hour and a half, and it's teaches you how to teach jazz. And that one right there is WBGO. It's one of the most prominent jazz radio stations, gives an award every year to advocate of jazz, and they gave it to the Thelonious Monk Institute of Jazz, and it shows me teaching these kids around the country. It's kind of cool.
Fantastic. So,
go to videos right there, go back to videos.
Okay.
And then go down to peer-to-peer.
Uh-huh.
These are all the tours we've done with these high school kids. There's last year in 2019 with Sean Jones. And you notice these kids come from all over the country. And that's with Steve Wilson, and that was in Oklahoma City. And then Sioux Falls, that was with Don Braden. And the kids that are listed are kids from these different high schools. There's Bobby Watson in St. Augustine, Florida. And Delfeayo Marsalis, that was in Dallas. And Lisa Henry's a former winner of the competition, and she's just fantastic with these kids. And so she's just about on all these tours. There's Antonio Hart. You know, we recorded at Van Gelder Studio when we were there.
Oh.
Where all the great Blue Note recordings were made. And
cool. Oh, and I see Jamel Dean is part of that. He
when he was in high school, yeah.
Yeah, he's pretty fabulous.
A lot of these kids have blossomed into great players. So some of these are just like two or three minute news clips, and some are the whole concert, you know. That's...
Let's watch one that's small.
Go to Christian McBride. That's one of my favorites.
Up above?
Yeah, 2012. Oh, nope, down. I'm sorry. It's in reverse chronological order.
Sorry, 2012. Here we go. Okay.
Yeah, there you go.
Today, the spirit of Thelonious Monk, one of the great jazz musicians of the
and
bebop
you can
era,
this.
Could be felt at
okay.
one Philadelphia high school. I was there to witness how some young, talented jazz musicians are keeping his memory alive. They are seven of the best jazz prodigies from across the country, here at Philadelphia High School of the Creative and Performing Arts, for one purpose.
There's music other than hip-hop.
Yeah, it's music other than hip-hop, Lil Wayne, Drake, even though they're great, but I think I'd much rather listen to Miles Davis or Coltrane.
They are sharing their passion as part of the Thelonious Monk Institute's peer-to-peer jazz program, a nonprofit educational organization established in the jazz legend's memory.
There's a performance for the entire student body today, and then following that will be a peer-to-peer jazz workshop where these kids who are from all over the country will be performing, playing alongside their Philadelphia peers.
Also joining the tour, the winner of this year's Grammy for Best Recording Artist and former student, Christian McBride.
When I was a student here at Kappa, and musicians like Winton and Branford Marsalis and Kenny Barron and the late Grover Washington Jr. and the Heath Brothers, all these musicians would take time out of their busy schedules to come here and teach us. Myself and Joey DeFrancesco and Questlove when we were all in high school, and the inspiration that we got from that, you see what it's done.
It's amazing that students from Philadelphia get to experience something so passionate.
It actually gives me like some courage that maybe I could make it.
Maybe you could, Dion. McBride and the young group will visit four more Philadelphia high schools. Then on Friday, you'll get to see them all perform at Chris's Jazz Cafe on Sansom Street at 8 or 10 p.m.
Oh, boy, I bet that was perfect.
I'm always blown away by talent like that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I saw you tweeting earlier today about how inspirational those
kids
were.
It really was. You just felt it inside.
Fantastic.
It was great.
Well, on that note, let's get another.
Yeah, that is really incredible. So God, your site is fantastic.
So, and Cathy, you'll notice.
Just checking your gallery too, man.
Oh, the
just for fun.
I just want to let you know that the vibes player.
Yeah.
That you just saw on that is Joel Ross.
Uh huh.
When he was in high school, he was a junior in high school at the time, and he just won the Critics Poll for Best Jazz Vibraphonist in Downbeat Magazine. And that was Adam O'Farrell on trumpet.
Oh.
And he's got a big career going on.
Certainly does, yeah. But you know, by the way, I love the name peer-to-peer. That is such a great name. You know, it's a great name for that.
Yeah, you know, I've studied with some of the greatest teachers, David Baker, Jamie Abersold. I mean, true jazz pedagogues. But I still say that I've learned more from my peers, my bandmates, than even these great teachers. And I think most of us do as jazz musicians.
Yeah. Just as a funny side note, my friend Roland wants to know if you've ever done acting because your face is familiar.
I was only as a kid. Only as a kid, but no, once I hit 13 or 14, I knew I was going to be a musician.
And plus, his dad said he wouldn't pay for college if he went into acting. So, however, Herbie Hancock has done some acting.
Oh, well, he's a terrific actor.
Yeah, he was on some science fiction thing, right? Remember? He was like a general or something.
One of the other things that we do, Cathy, is that we have our Jazz in America website. And Jazz in America website is a complete jazz history and appreciation course, 8 sessions. And we have it, it's 3 tracks. There's 1 track of 8 lesson plans for elementary students, 1 track for middle school students, and 1 track for high school students. Now, if you click onto the Journeys into Jazz on the left, you'll see an animated Herbie Hancock with Herbie Hancock acting, but it's animated. Check this out.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Journeys into Jazz. My name is Herbie Hancock, and I'll be your guide through this one-of-a-kind exploration through the history of one of America's greatest creations, jazz. Now, there are many ways to learn about jazz. You can listen to recordings from the hundreds of jazz musicians out there, read magazines and books about jazz, and go to concerts and listen to jazz in its purest form, live. But so that you can learn about jazz and its rich history right now, my friends and I have worked very hard, day and night, on a very special invention. I call it the Memorized Logarithmic Deporter to Yesteryear. Of course, that's just a scientific name for our amazing jazz time machine, and it can be quite a mouthful. So, in order to refer to my invention more easily, I took the first 1 or 2 letters of each of those words and gave her a nickname. I call her Melody, for short. After all, one of the best ways to know where you're going in jazz is to just follow the melody. Well, don't just stand there. Let's go. Jump on in, buckle up, and let's get our first lesson going. Double time now. Okay, you all settle inside? Let's get this baby moving. Oh, I should warn you, this may be a bumpy ride, as I haven't quite tested her every feature yet. Really, any of her features. Okay, I've never used her before, but I assure you, she is completely safe. Oh yeah, in order to work the controls, you must successfully answer questions about what you learn along the way. The first thing you need to learn about jazz is that it is America's music. That is, it was invented by Americans in America. Today, jazz is played and enjoyed by people all over the globe and is considered one of America's greatest gifts to the world. Well, that reminds me. Before we get underway, there's one more thing I want to talk about, and that's improvisation, one of the most important elements in jazz. The word improvisation simply means doing something extemporaneously, that is, spontaneously. Not written down or planned ahead of time. In most other styles of music, like classical and pop, most of the music is composed beforehand. But in jazz, most of the music is improvised. That is, the musicians create the music as they are playing. It's kind of like musical conversation. When you talk with your friends, you're actually improvising using words. Well, jazz musicians do the same thing, but rather than using words, they express themselves using music. No song is ever played the same way twice, so you never know ahead of time how it's going to turn out. That's one of the things that makes jazz so exciting. Okay, so without further ado, let's get the show on the road. But let's make this interesting. To get Melody to take us back into time to the birthplace of jazz so we can see where and how it all started, and to assure me that I haven't been talking to myself this whole time, you must answer a couple of quick questions.
Cool.
Go for it, Cathy.
Should I? Okay. It was born in, I think, the United States. Playing music. Boring. That was easy.
The great thing about Melody
is
that she has the ability to morph into the common mode of transportation of the day so that we can travel inconspicuously.
Can I actually stop?
That is, without being noticed, you know, so we can blend right in.
Yeah, just go ahead and hit the home page.
We're now in the early 1900s in the city known as the birthplace of jazz.
Oh, interesting.
New Orleans, Louisiana.
Let's see. I could go backwards, but for some reason I couldn't go, I couldn't use my little hand thing. This is great. You know, actually, I wonder if my young grandchildren could actually make their way around this, you know, because I keep trying to imagine how, you know, they're not listening to jazz at home. I keep thinking of having a music night where we can all get together and everybody can play something for everybody and we'll all listen. You know, and of course, I would be playing some jazz and classical, which they probably aren't listening to also. So, but this is, would you say the lesson plans would be understandable for children?
Yes, go ahead and click on lesson plans. And there you have grade 5, that's for elementary.
Yeah.
Grade 8, that's for middle school. Grade 11, that's for high school. And all, it's filled with videos and tune snippets and just great stuff on how jazz came about and how important and what it means in society. There's there's essays on this thing for the 11th graders about jazz and racism and the different cultural implications and lots of great American history stuff. Basically, this was designed so that social studies and American history teachers could use it in their classrooms to teach 8 lesson plans to non-music students, you know, American history, social studies classes, and there's 8 lesson plans, and it was originally designed to use in Black History Month, where they would do 2 lesson plans a week, 8 lesson plans altogether for the month of February. Yeah. But we found that people use it all year round. They have the autonomy to do it however they want. There's lots of videos. I mean, there's a great video, you know, talking about, you know, what ragtime music is.
Hmm.
And I mean, it goes in chronological order. And so you see, Bach's Minuet in G, as Bach wrote it, and with a, you know, professional classical musician playing it. And then moving on to how a ragtime player plays it, Bach's Minuet in G, and then like a bebop group. So they can really see this was Bach's Minuet in G, da ba ba do bu da 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 to da zu ba do bu di di do li do bu di So it's got a lot of cool and fun stuff.
Yeah.
The history of the saxophone is on here. You know, where the history of the piano, Chris Bowers, who's one of our former students, one of our peer-to-peer students, who is now a film composer, and he wrote the music and played piano for The Green Book, which won the Academy Award for Best Picture a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
He's on here doing a history of the jazz of piano, where he starts off with Scott Joplin and plays like 10 or 15 seconds of all these styles all the way up to, you know, Chick Corea, Herbie Hancock, and beyond. And it's amazing. I mean, all this stuff is on here. It's a really a beautiful thing.
Yeah. You know, also, I wanted to just check you out because I actually came across you teaching, and I just thought it was pretty cool. You know, like in a class, would this be something just to peek in on a little bit? Or
I think the best one to do would be go to the beginning of that list.
I saw you in a classroom.
Oh, that might have been JB Masterclass. That's long.
But it would be nice just to see a little bit of it.
Sure, you could take a listen. Thanks, everybody. It's great to be here. I come to New Orleans 1 week a month from our Los Angeles office, and it's always a treat to come back to the birthplace of jazz. I always learn so much from the music that's being played here now and the music that's coming up from the young people in this town. And what I'm going to do today is talk about how to maximize your time in getting jazz in your classroom. Whether that's jazz in your social studies and American history classroom to help generate jazz audiences for the future, or if it's in your big band, or if it's in your combo.
Now, were you?
I do clinics all over the country. I go in and I look at and listen to jazz bands all over. I mean, 50 states. And I also teach at the Jamie Abersold Summer Jazz Camp every summer. And it never ceases to amaze me. By the way, I'm a bassist. It never ceases to amaze me when the bass players come in for their audition for placement to see if they're going to be in combo 1, combo 10, combo 30, combo 40. We rate them. So we put the best kids with the best kids and the less experienced kids with the less experienced kids, so they all get to play in a combo of their peers. So we ask the bass player, first of all, a couple of questions like, hey, how's it going? How are you? Where are you from? Try to make them relax. How old are you? 17. Tell me a little bit about your jazz experience. Well, I've been playing in my jazz band since 7th grade, so I've been playing in 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th. I've been playing 5 years. I'm going into my senior year. And so I'll say, okay, why don't we just start with having you walk a blues? And please walk a blues. And they go, well, what do you mean? And I'll say, well, can you walk a blues? And which is one of the most fundamental things you need to do as a bass player. They go, no. Then I'll give them some chord symbols. Can you walk with these chord symbols? No, all I do is read the notes. Same thing happens with piano. Been playing in jazz band for 5 years. They're playing triads and basic seventh chords. Same thing with the guitar players. The guitar players come in and they've got the guitars down to here and they're playing rock and roll bar chords, completely inappropriate for jazz. And you say, well, how long have you been playing in jazz band? Sometimes it's three, four years. So what I want to do today is show you how you can maximize your time to get these players to, first of all, understand what jazz is. Sometimes I ask, what's a chorus? And they've been playing in jazz band for 4 or 5 years and they don't know what a chorus is. So the very first step, and this would be your first day of class, whether you're teaching musicians or non-musicians, you tell them what jazz is. Now, of course, there's volumes written on what jazz is, but the main thing that you want to get across is the basic essence of what jazz is about and the basic musical elements of jazz. Even for your non-music students, and I've done this for fifth graders and they get it, because the idea is that if they understand what's going on in a jazz performance musically, even if they don't know, you know, how to voice chords or play an instrument, but they understand what's going on, they're much more likely to appreciate jazz more and be more of a jazz connoisseur and have their lives enriched through this great art form. So the very first thing you want to tell your students is that jazz is America's music, that jazz was born in this country. that jazz evolved, was invented by, and evolved through the African-American experience in America. Now, a lot of people think that jazz came from Africa. That's not true. True, African-Americans were the primary innovators of this music. But the music didn't come from Africa. The music came from America, and you want to emphasize African-Americans. So in a nutshell, what jazz is, it's a marriage between two musical traditions, between the African musical tradition and the European musical tradition. So what you have is you have certain elements coming from the African tradition and certain elements coming from the European tradition. Well, what do you get from Africa? The first thing you get from Africa is the rhythms that you hear in jazz, the polyrhythms, the syncopated rhythms, the rhythms on top of rhythms. That is an African tradition. The other element that you get from Africa is the sensibility of playing in your own distinct voice. In classical music, for instance, if you're auditioning for a job in the New York Philharmonic and you sound different than everybody else in the section, in other words, if your bow's going north while theirs are going south, and you can stand out that this person's really not blending, you're not going to get that gig. But in jazz, you want to have your own personal voice. So a jazz musician will play in his or her own personal way, and that sensibility comes from Africa.
Okay, I'm going to just stop because I want to talk to.
But it goes on for a while.
You speak really well, and I'm not surprised because you've been doing it for so long, and it's very clear to you. I think that's great. It's really, really interesting. And you do this all the time. You travel a lot, I'm guessing, or you have.
Yeah, we're in 12 performing arts high schools around the country, you know, all the way from New York to San Francisco and Los Angeles, New Orleans, Miami, New Orleans, Chicago. I visit these schools for at least three days a year, some more often, and I haven't been since the pandemic, except for I just did my three-day residency at the Los Angeles County High School for the Arts.
Yeah.
I'll be going to Miami in December, and then I'll be hitting the road in January and February to hit all the other schools.
God. By the way, this woman, Norma Jean Garza, said she really appreciates this segment. Her three sisters are educators, and her daughter-in-law is a professor. So this topic means so much to her since the family females are all about educating our children for a world that will heal and prosper through better education and music. Thank you, Dr. Dyas.
Love it. Thank you.
It's so nice, isn't it? What a nice comment. Thanks, Norma Jean. I was going to ask you, I mean, I kind of know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask anyway. How is the response? Is the response overwhelmingly wonderful? Are there always a number of people who are really interested in what you're talking about?
It's amazing. When we go into these schools, into these high schools, and you know, with these peer-to-peer kids, these are kids who are their same age, they look like them, they talk like them.
Yeah.
But they can, you know, they can really play. And we do an assembly program. The assembly program is packed. And again, this is all pre-pandemic, but we're going to be hitting the road again in the spring, going to Wisconsin and Delaware. And I see these kids, I introduce the thing, but then the kids and the artist, Lisa Henry, and whether it's Bobby Watson or Ingrid Jensen or whoever it is, they lead it. I do like a 10-minute what is jazz thing in the middle. But I see these kids shuffle into the auditorium, you know. You ain't gonna make me learn. At least I get out of school. At least I get out of class, but I ain't gonna learn anything. You know, I can't hear you. You ain't gonna make me learn. And, you know, they're in their phones and halfway through the concert, I'm seeing them, and I love watching the students more than I like watching the band. You know, I love watching the kids, and they're paying attention, they're listening, and then we do question and answers. Question and answer. So a kid will say, you know, well, how much do you practice? And the answer will be, well, I practice all the time. It's what I do. It's my thing. So I wake up in the morning, I put on my earbuds, and I'm listening, and I'm playing at school, and I'm practicing. And so it's not a question of sitting down for 2 or 3 hours doing something that I hate. I love doing it. I found a passion for something, and that's what everyone should do in here. And then another, and he goes on to say, you know, frankly, no disrespect, as he looks over to me, but the previous generation didn't leave us in the best of shape here. It's up to us. It's up to you and me. Now, this is a 16-year-old kid saying this to, you know, audience of about 900 kids in the auditorium. He said, so whatever you get into, engineering, computer, law, medicine, whatever, find a passion for something. He said, maybe somebody in here will invent a car that runs on water or runs on air. Maybe it'll be you, or maybe it'll be you. And the vibe in the room is just lifted, and people are cheering and just loving these kids.
Wow.
And then we do a workshop afterwards for the kids' jazz band, for the host school's jazz band, where the kids sit side by side and teach their peers, their younger, less experienced peers. You don't have to tongue every note like that. Here, do some sort of, rather than ta 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 ba do li do ba ba do. And the guitar player said, lift that strap up. Here, rather than playing these bar chords, try playing your C7 like this. Here's like a nice C ninth chord, you know. See how much hipper that sounds, and don't strum it, but maybe pick and thin. And so they learn more from that kid in an hour than they learn from their band director all year long.
Mm.
So it's the drummers here. You need to hold your stick like this, man. And there you go. Keep that hi hat going. They've been in band for a whole year, and the band director never told him he needs to play the hi hat louder, and make it crisp, so it doesn't sound like a parade drum, you know, a parade cymbal. So they learn more in that hour clinic from the kids with the band, with, you know, whoever our guest artist is in front, whether it's Christian McBride, like you saw, or Bobby Watson, than they do from their band director. So everybody learns. It's 360 degrees. These kids are teaching kids. The band directors are watching, so they're kind of getting vicariously how to direct a jazz band technique, and so the kids who are on the tour are learning from the jazz artist, just like they learned from Art Blakey in the day. So they're learning from the jazz artist, and in turn they're teaching their brethren, kids their same age, about these important values that jazz represents. It's 360 degree teaching and learning.
It's really exciting. I totally love it. See, you know, I've taught in a bunch of universities, but this kind of a thing I'd probably be still teaching, you know, if I had, or teaching in universities still, because, you know, I don't have to tell you, it's hard in regular universities. So it can be because of the, basically how it's coming down from the top. Somebody up top feels it should be a certain way, and that's it. You know, it's not going to change. But a school like you're involved in, I mean, that's what it's about. And I think whoever's responsible for coming, you are responsible for some of the ideas formulating. And then, but there's a number, it seems like probably there's a number of people responsible for formulating ideas of furthering the information.
The most important people,
yeah,
are not me or my good friend and colleague Dan Seif, who administers college program.
Mm-hmm.
The most important people are the development people. Tom Carter, who's the director, who's the president of the Institute, and everyone that works on raising the money, because everything we provide for free. And we're loaded with great ideas. Heck, I have trouble not tripping over good ideas when I get up in the morning. But how are we going to pay for them? And it's the development people, the people that are raising the money from, like, United Airlines is one of our great sponsors. They fly us all over and our kids all over for free.
Yeah.
Toyota, great corporate sponsorship with International Jazz Day. Northrop Grumman, the National Endowment for the Arts helps sponsor these peer-to-peer tours. You know, and then, of course, private donations. Giving Tuesday's coming up, so we have a campaign for that. So we have loads and loads of great ideas, but it's the development people who raise the money that go out there, and grant writers. We do a lot of grant writing. We have a fantastic grant writer in Washington, D.C. She's amazing, where we apply for grants from public and private grants. I know that several years ago, Prudential Insurance gave us a grant to do 3 years in Newark. And so I was there at the at Arts High School in Newark. I was going to, working there 2 or 3 weeks a year, a week at a time, or 3 or 4 days at a time. And that was the first performing arts high school in the country, in Newark. That's Wayne Shorter's alma mater. And Woody Shaw went there, and Sarah Vaughan, and Connie Francis. So things like that, you know, negotiating that kind of deal. A lot of these corporations, they're philanthropic, and they want to give back.
Yeah. We're kind of winding down to the last 15 minutes or so, and I'm wondering, do you want to say anything specific to people listening, either young people or old people or the general public or musicians? Anything come to mind?
I just want to let everyone know that, if they're interested in the Herbie Hancock Institute and what we do and how to get involved, and just go to our website at hancockinstitute.org. HancockInstitute.org. My website is JB Dyas, J-B-D-Y-A-S, jbdyas.com. And everything is provided free, again, because of these wonderful philanthropic and generous sponsors, corporate, public, private, everything. So HancockInstitute.org is a good place to start. And all my pedagogy, all the things that I teach, all my handouts, all my packets, they're all available free at jbdyas.com.
Pretty cool. I'm kind of giggling here because people always ask me, they're intrigued by what appears, and it's always appeared in my life, to be a constant creative source of new ideas, you know, new things to do, involving the community. Actually, Sunday I was part of an event that honored 12 of us for contributing to the jazz community here. And but aside from that, people are always saying, don't you ever stop, or you must be a workaholic, or how do you keep, you know, ideas going? But it's making me laugh because I'm just like this one person, and you are this kind of spontaneous combustion of a group, and you all seem to be doing that together, and it's mind-blowing for me. It's wonderful. I love this kind of energy, you know.
Well, being a jazz musician and a jazz pedagogue and a jazz educator,
yeah,
I say this all the time, it's not what I do. It is what I do, but it's more than that. It's
what you love.
Yeah, and it's who I am.
Yeah.
And the beauty, and this is how jazz musicians are. Very, very few gigs very few occupations, you want to do what you're doing for a living as soon as you get off.
Yeah.
You know, we always talk about that, that, you know, someone's working at a factory or doing a job they don't like, and, you know, at 5 o'clock, hey, let's go down and work at another factory. Or let's go watch these other guys work at the factory doing the same thing, but maybe they're doing it differently or better.
Yeah.
And that's just how we are as a people. I know that, you know, when we would finish our gigs at, you know, 1 a.m, we would go and catch somebody else's set that played till 2:30. You know,
yeah.
We just, you know, couldn't get enough. And then you wake up and you start listening. And I just always advocate kids. I've seen kids, especially in the last 15 or 20 years, having a more difficult time finding a passion like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I go into some of these schools, and I have to tell you, Cathy, sometimes I just don't see any life in their eyes, you know, in these public schools, whether they're inner city or rural or anywhere in between. It's like, and you gotta, that's the thing. And these jazz kids, they say, you gotta find a passion for something, believe in yourself, and go for it.
That's so cool. Norma Jean mentioned that this is pretty cute. If only there was a HancockInstitute.org class for toddlers.
You know, jazz at Lincoln Center.
Yeah.
You know, one of our colleagues there, or one of our, you know, another great jazz education organization. They have Webop. Check it out. Go to Google. Oh. Go to Jazz at Lincoln Center. Webop.
Wow.
And it's for toddlers.
They, yeah,
get them into it. Not Bebop, Webop.
Jazz at Lincoln Center has Webop.
Yeah, Webop.
That's funny.
It's a program, and I think there's stuff you can do online with that too.
Oh my God, that's.
But you know, the Jazz in America site, you know, with Herbie Hancock taking you back in his virtual time machine. You know, we made that for elementary kids in mind. But we're finding all the high school and college kids and adults love it even more. So it's cool. And Herbie's, what a great actor. Hey, everybody, welcome to Journeys into Jazz. It's like, come on, Herbie.
Totally.
Don't get buried in the part, man.
who doesn't love Herbie Hancock?
You know, it's interesting. It's interesting that... The gig right before this was, I was the executive director of the Brubeck Institute.
And
the best thing about that gig, Cathy, was that I got to be very good friends and very close to Dave Brubeck. He became like my grandfather. This guy is...
Now he was he's been a never-ending, right?
I have had so many good conversations with Dave. What's best to play for? Do you play for the audience or do you play for yourself? No, JB, you always play for yourself, unless it's a very good audience. And I said, you know, people talk about, should you go to school to study jazz, not go to school, use play-along records, watch your hands, look at your bandmates. What's the best way to learn how to play jazz, Dave? And he said, any way you get there is the right way. And I just thought, this guy is so wise. I just love this guy. So I said, how did you come up with writing such a great tune like The Duke? He said, well, I was driving and the windshield wipers were going, shoo, shoo. And I just thought, and I went, this guy's a genius. I listen to the wipers, man. Nothing like that comes to me. And then Herbie Hancock. And, you know, you look at all these different jazz musicians. Like, you take someone like Wynton Marsalis. He's got people that love him, and he's got people that don't love him. You know, there's all these... You have all these controversies with this musician and that musician. They don't like this person. They do like this person. But everybody loves Dave Brubeck. And everybody loves Herbie Hancock. So I feel so blessed to my two main bosses in my career have been the people that everybody love.
Yeah. Do you get to play anymore?
I do. I just play regular dates.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I'm in a position where I, you know, I don't have to play. I mean, when I was a kid, there were dates where I was playing 350 dates a year. Yeah. I mean, I was working more 7 nights a week than 6 nights a week.
Yeah.
Playing every wedding by miss. I mean, we do 5 weddings in a weekend, two on Friday, one on Friday, two on Saturday, two on Sunday. Yeah. I mean, just playing every kind of gig imaginable because you needed to make the rent and you had,
yeah,
to, you
know, absolutely.
You had to do it. And I learned so much from that experience.
Yeah.
One thing I learned was how important it is to be a pro.
Mm-hmm.
To be a pro, and you get a dig from that. Maybe you're not playing something artistic, but you get a dig, you get a good feeling because
yeah.
you're doing it authentically. You're playing the bag, you're playing the authentic bag authentically, and you're doing a good job. And so I learned that from playing. But yes, I still play and I still practice. During the pandemic, I got a resurgence of practicing. I hadn't practiced for a few years, except for, you know, practicing for a particular gig or practicing for a particular thing coming up. But the pandemic, I said, I've got some time here and I'm going to get myself back on a regimen. And I haven't practiced like this since I was a kid. So it feels really, really good again. And I'm playing with the memorizing tunes, getting all these bebop heads on bass that I've known for years, but not under my fingers.
That's cool.
Stuff
it's also
like that.
Amazing that you have time to do that.
Yeah, well, it's now, you know, now that we're back in session, not so yeah. much, but when you're at home, you're not having to do the commute, and I'm not having to, you know, rather than being on a plane, I'm sitting home practicing, you know.
That's great. Love it. Gosh, I want to thank you so much for this conversation, and it's very inspiring. I know I'm going to get more involved. And I know definitely people who have watched this or who will watch it will get more involved as well. It's just, it makes me feel great. Actually, my friend Roland, he said, you know me, Kath, this is so amazingly wonderful. I'm welling up from how emotional it is for me. Thanks for introducing this wonderful pedagogue. So that's quite a
thank you for that
nice comment.
That touches my heart. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
You know, as far as I consider, and I when I do my jazz pedagogy courses and I'm teaching future teachers, I say that being a jazz educator, being a jazz teacher, you should treat it as an art form, just like jazz is an art form. And how do you learn how to play jazz? Well, you listen to all these people play and you're inspired by them and you transcribe them and you emulate them. And then that's your point of departure to find your own way of
yeah.
doing it based on all of this great knowledge that you've learned. And I say the same thing to future jazz educators, that take what I do, you know, transcribe, quote unquote, transcribe what I do, try some of my things, you know, do it, but then make that your point of departure to find your own innovative way to teach the subject matter, just like you find your own innovative way to play
yeah.
music.
Yeah. Okay, JB Dyas.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so very much. It was really inspiring. And I'm going to, would you rather hard copies of CDs and DVDs, or would you rather on, you know, digital?
I'd rather CDs, just
okay.
because they sound so much better. And I'm one of these cats that still listens to CDs. It just sounds so much better.
Okay, and
albums still sound the best, you know, LPs.
Yeah.
But that ship has really sailed. It takes so
yeah.
much effort. You know,
yeah.
I mean, doing all the, I mean, really it's nothing, but with this fast paced society, instant gratification society, people don't even want to put a CD in anymore.
But
I do, I like the CDs, and I like on Social Anthems, which I just got from Origin Records, your CD, it's nice reading the liner notes, and it's nice, you know, seeing who the cats are and the beautiful the beautiful artwork. It's part of the experience for me.
Yeah, I agree. Actually, I've been trying to listen to some of my records that I picked up, but like from garage sales and stuff, you know. This year I went to Carla Bley, and what was the title of that record? It was, I can't remember the title of it. It's one word, like evolution or something like that. Anyway, mind-blowingly great. And just to put the record on and be in the space of that, it was like a probably an octet or something. Oh, it was just incredible. Just incredible. I played it over and over again. It was just really nice. So the experience of that is, it makes you slow down too. Because if you're doing it digitally, you can do it digitally and actually get into doing other things, which I don't love to do when I'm listening to really good music. So having a record on, especially, you really have to pay attention. because it will get to the end of the record, you know. So wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
Yeah, it's a double-edged sword. It's never been easier to listen to music now.
Yeah.
I mean, you find it on YouTube. I mean, it's never been easier. And people have, I mean, they have, literally thousands of tunes. Yeah. So that's the good news. The bad news is they're not giving anything real concentrated listening.
Yeah.
I mean, we would listen to the same, we'd wear out the grooves when we were kids, you know,
yeah.
Listen to the same solo over and over and over. Now they listen to it once, they move on, you know.
Yes. Oh my God, that is so true. That is so true. Yeah. There were several records that I had to buy again. Yeah, a Miles one that I played every morning when I in college. I would get up and put on this one Miles album. Also, Marvin Gaye was like a big thing for me too.
Well, you got a Marvin Gaye tune on your last record.
I know, God, that was a great period of time for me.
Yeah, I love, you know, Stephen Stills. Who would have thought that he would write a jazz tune? But you hear it on your record.
I'm glad you like it. Tomorrow I'm having Ed Bennett on. Do you know Ed Bennett, the bassist?
I don't know Ed.
He lives up the coast, and he used to live here for a long time. He's played with a lot of heavyweight people. Great bass player. And, yes, Roland, thank you. Oh, that's because I got the record from you. Carla Bley, Social Studies. great album. What a great album. Thanks, Roland. I forget what I was saying, but tomorrow, Ed Bennett. So I'll leave it at that, because Thursday through Sunday, I post archives usually. And, people can see who I'm having if they go on my website and look at the event page. And thanks.
Well, it's great that you're doing this. This is so cool. It enriches a lot of people's lives, and people become more and more educated every time.
Yeah, it puts out waves. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's because we're all creating this. Really, we're all creating the tapestry of life by our individual waves, and you and I have this kind of jazzy wave. And I do intend to come over sometime too. I'm going to have to call you and find out when I can come over and listen.
Yeah, we have these open master classes every now and then.
Yeah.
And we haven't had one yet this semester. We haven't had one of these open master classes since the pandemic, because UCLA is really strict. You know, we get tested either 2 or 3 days a week, depending on how many days you're here.
Yeah.
Plus you have to be vaccinated.
Yeah.
And they just haven't opened it up yet. We're hoping that will change next semester. And then you can come over and hear these wonderful fellows play. We call them the fellows because they all have gotten the fellowships. These are the college students, and sit in on a session where they're being taught by one of these jazz masters.
Great. I look forward to that.
Thank you, Cathy.
Baby, it was a pleasure.
Have a good holiday.
Thank you. You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye, everybody. Thanks for being here. And I just want to say that was really very inspirational. Actually, now that I'm not holding JB on Zoom here, I'll tell you, after Ed Bennett, Thursday is Lamont Van Hook, who is great background singer. He's sung a lot with Peter Gabriel. And also he has a solo career too. Friday is Clarice Assad, an amazing Brazilian singer, pianist, composer. And her father and his brother were famous. They're the Assad brothers, famous guitarists, who a lot of people know about. And she's amazing, totally amazing. And she was doing a show too, which I didn't follow up and listen to a lot, but she's a really interesting person. That's Friday. Saturday, Pierre Chambers, a vocalist who lives in LA, who I'm actually producing his debut CD, and he's the son of Paul Chambers, one of the most famous and prolific jazz bass players who ever lived. And then Sunday, Gail Boyd, who is a jazz manager. She manages John Clayton's band, amongst others. She's on the East Coast, and she has a wonderful show on every day at 2. Every day at 2. And you can really see a lot of incredible people. Actually, yesterday I watched Scott Yanow, who's a jazz critic, and he lives in Los Angeles. So what she does is, I've done the show too, she gives the artist a half hour, and the artist does whatever they want. They can play, they can talk, whatever. So that's really interesting. So again, if you want to find out who is going to be on, just go to my website, and I have it pretty updated. You can also join my mailing list. All righty, thank you so much. It was such a good jazz day. Have a great day, and I'll see you tomorrow, maybe. Bye, y'all.